It would start with a blast, a huge mass of plasma spewing from the surface of the sun.
These are giant eruptions that can send the energy equivalent of 10,000 Category 5 hurricanes hurtling through space in some direction. Sometimes they hit Earth.
Energetic particles could knock into satellites, disrupting GPS. Astronauts could get hit with a heavy dose of radiation. Geomagnetic disturbances could knock out power grids. In a severe case, this could last hours, days, or even weeks in some places. Economists who've modeled this out place potential risks at tens of billions of dollars per day.
Because the last really big solar storm to hit the Earth happened in the late 1800s, there just wasn't all of this electronic and grid and space infrastructure that we rely on now. So some of that infrastructure could be affected by a big solar storm.
Severe solar storms don't hit Earth often, but scientists and utilities operators spend time preparing for them because they're inevitable and potentially catastrophic. Solar storms often have a few major components: solar flares, solar energetic particles, and coronal mass ejections.
The sun is essentially a boiling ball of gas. When you're making pasta, right, you get those bubbles in a convection pattern that are coming to the surface and then releasing their air into the steam. It's very similar to that on the surface of the sun, right? We have these convection patterns that we can actually see where you have hotter plasma from the interior of the sun that's coming up, and then it cools and it goes back down. As those things convect, we also have not only the hot ionized gas, but also the electromagnetic fields are tied up with that plasma. And so the configuration of those electromagnetic fields can actually cause some of that plasma to come up above the visible surface of the sun. And as it comes up, you can kind of think about it like a soap bubble, right? It extends to a point where it no longer is stable and kind of pinches off that bubble of plasma that can then go streaming into space.
Economists have modeled exactly how all this science could play out and cost the US economy billions of dollars.
So we know that if there was a space weather event, it would mean that the US economy would see somewhere between $10 to $40 billion worth of gross domestic product lost per day. So it depends how many days potentially the grid might be down.
Edward Otten has spent the last decade modeling the socioeconomic impacts of severe space weather.
Satellite constellations would be the first assets that would be affected. The radiation impacts that take place from the solar flare would affect those assets in orbit.
The next wave of effects could hit anywhere from 16 hours to several days later.
Essentially, you would start to see power grids on the dark side of the Earth being affected. Geomagnetic storms induce geomagnetic currents, which flow into the power grids and cause problems with the operation of that particular infrastructure system. And obviously, if we lose power, then we're likely to lose a lot of other key lifeline critical infrastructures which we all depend on: telecommunications, transportation services, water services, financial services. These types of really important things that we all use on a daily basis.
Experts have long disagreed on how severe the ramifications might be. Some have hypothesized a so-called internet apocalypse that could disconnect entire countries from the web, or power outages that would last years.
The debate was whether this might take months or years to replace damaged critical infrastructure assets such as extra high voltage transformers. But I think the key point to make is that once the grid's actually shut itself off, it's not exposed anymore. I think there's a lot that we don't know. We don't have the data to understand how many of those critical infrastructure sectors actually connect together. It's those types of unpredictable outcomes that plague our models.
Significant solar storms have hit Earth before.
Like a big circuit breaker, the whole system shut down. They don't know, but they suspect it may have something to do with solar flares.
When you ask scientists about this, they'll say that a really devastating solar storm happens on Earth only about once every 150 years. The most famous solar storm happened in the late 1800s. That was called the Carrington event. And it was such a big solar storm that it caused the aurora, you know, the northern lights, to go all the way down. You could see it in the Caribbean at the time. And it caused telegraph lines to kind of be overloaded by electrical charge, and they sparked, and some of them caught fire, and it shut down the telegraph system in North America. But there have been many solar storms since. In the 1920s, there was one that shut down railroads in and around New York City and caused a building to catch fire. There was one in the 1970s which set off 4,000 magnetically sensitive undersea mines in the waters off Vietnam. And at the same time, it fooled a Department of Defense satellite into thinking that the Russians had set off a nuclear bomb. And most recently, in 1989, there was a large solar storm which actually shut down the power grid in Quebec for 9 hours.
The 1989 solar storm caused 6 million people to lose power in Quebec. But that was a much smaller coronal mass ejection than the ones many experts worry about today.
We're seeing an increased number of solar storms. We've been a little bit excited about how active the sun is getting because it's a very exciting time to be studying the sun and near Earth space. That being said, it also means that there's a lot more complications from space weather that are potentially there because we haven't experienced them over the last, you know, 2 decades or so.
To avoid a worst-case scenario, scientists and industry experts have been working on better forecasting tools and industry safeguards.
We actually have this obscure corner of the federal government called the Space Weather Prediction Center, and they're able to give us some advanced warning, but it's limited because our best probe for assessing whether a solar storm is coming toward us can only give us maybe an hour's notice, maybe a half hour.
There's a lot of complicated physics that we have to try to model, and trying to do that in this entire coupled system from the sun to the ground at Earth takes a lot of computing power. Luckily, we now have computers that can handle that. We also have more data coming online, especially from new spacecraft, and we're able to ingest more of that data into what we call empirical models. And then last but not least, we also have new techniques like machine learning and artificial intelligence, which is kind of this burgeoning field that we're able to start applying to space weather and, you know, what is a very hard problem that might be well suited to some of these techniques.
Given some warning, power grid operators could deploy crews to make sure critical components like transformers are working properly and try to keep components from overheating. Satellites could be moved into a safe hold configuration.
Space weather has really been a growing emphasis over the last few decades. It's definitely something that the federal government is getting more and more acute awareness of.
In the past decade, regulators have begun to issue guidelines to deal with the threat of solar storms. After years of experts flagging concerns, groups like the North American Electric Reliability Corporation began to develop and enforce standards for grid operators to mitigate the effects. Many experts are optimistic that Earth will be able to avoid a worst-case scenario the next time a major solar storm hits. But it's impossible to precisely simulate a solar storm that hasn't happened yet.
I think the number one concern among the experts that I've talked to about what's it going to take for us to really be prepared for solar storms is that one will hit and some of its impacts will be ones that we just didn't really predict. Like maybe we were prepared for a certain type of big flux of electricity in the grid and it overwhelming transformers, but maybe there's some other part of the grid that we're just not even thinking about that gets tripped by this. So I think experts are the most worried about the unknown unknowns that'll occur the next time we have a big solar storm.